Hi, I'm Rick Van Ness, and this is rule number four, diversify. By now you might be wondering how to go about choosing a stock fund. What stocks should you buy, and how much of each? Diversifying the stocks you own is the heart of long-term investing. Before I explain, let's consider your choices. If you want to beat the market's average return, because average sounds mediocre, the problem is you don't know which stock to buy. So you could consider choosing a dozen prospects to hedge your bets. Or maybe you like the idea of hiring a professional to do this for you with an actively managed fund. Either way, if this sounds like the best strategy, click pick the best stocks. Companies often fail, or at least fade, and if your goal is for any company failure to have as little effect on your wealth as possible, you would spread your money evenly over as many stocks as you can. If this sounds like the best strategy, click lessen the impact of failures. Most of you are trying to grow your wealth, and your goal might be to get the maximum return from a portfolio of stocks for the least amount of risk possible. That would lead you to a different strategy. So click maximize return for risk. We'll discuss what you choose, and then I'll show you something fascinating. If your goal is to beat the market return, then you would want to choose the most promising company stock and put all your eggs in that basket. That's what Warren Buffett does, but he cautions that this strategy is only for professionals who make this their business. He's not going to win big by choosing a dozen companies, so he tries to bet on one or two, three at the most. And he's very active in making his predictions unfold. But Warren Buffett cautions, if this is not your career, then you should take the exact opposite approach. He asserts for 99% of you, maybe more, your strategy should be extreme diversification. Own a slice of the total market. Continue if you'd like to learn how to do that. I will teach you why it is both extraordinary and simple. Oh, and by the way, you are well above average if you consistently earn the market return. Most investors don't, and I'll explain that in later rules. Companies fail for many reasons. You probably recognize some of these as companies that failed to innovate and lost their market leadership. You grew up knowing not to put all your eggs into one basket. So this strategy would suggest that you spread your money evenly over as many stocks as you can. This would dilute the losers. But there's a better strategy, one that will give you the highest return for the volatility risk that you take. Continue if you'd like to learn how to do that. I will teach you why it is both extraordinary and simple. In his colorful way, John Bogle told us the answer. Don't look for the needle in the haystack, buy the whole haystack. But I don't want you to just smile and admire his clever wit, which helps make this memorable. I want you to understand why this is brilliant and genius and might be different from what you imagined. We're going to see that it's not enough to simply own hundreds of companies. There's an especially interesting portfolio. You will learn what that portfolio is and why you would want to own it, why everyone in the world would want to own it, and where you should put your money for the highest return for the least amount of risk. First, you'll learn the great advantage of owning poorly correlated assets. This part is truly cool, magical. To help me show you, let's imagine two companies, Bathing Suits Incorporated and National Umbrella Company. A rainy year means that the sales of Bathing Suit Company will fall, but the Umbrella Company does well. In a sunny year, the Bathing Suit Company does well and the sales of umbrellas fall. The price of these company stocks move in opposite directions, so they are negatively correlated. The Bathing Suit Company is more volatile because the total annual return has an average value of 7% but a variable component of plus or minus 1%. This is both higher return and higher risk than the Umbrella Company, which has an average return of 3.5% plus or minus 0.5%. This is the magical part. Look what happens if you invest 2/3 of your money in the Umbrella Company and 1/3 in the Bathing Suit Company. Wow! Adding some of the more volatile company not only increases the average return, but it lowers the variability or risk. Pretty much a free lunch. Here's what it looks like on a risk return chart. The bathing suit company is up here with twice the expected risk and return as the umbrella company. If you owned 100% of the umbrella company, you'd be here. Now, if you gradually invest part of your portfolio in the more risky bathing suit company, your returns increase as you'd expect, but your risk, as measured by the variability of that return, actually decreases. Owning both is superior to only owning either of these companies. Let's return to the real world with real companies and real choices. We can represent a stock's expected return as its average value and its risk as the volatility or standard deviation about that average return value. We can compare them on this risk return map. Now we are going to make two assumptions: that investors are rational and will prefer higher returns to lower returns, and less risk to more risk, measured by volatility. Now consider this. You want to do some long-term investing in the stock market, and you can invest in any of these four stocks, or any combination of these that you wish. Pick one of these four choices, and then we'll discuss. Would you choose Motorola because it has enjoyed this high average return? Would you choose Merck Pharmaceutical because it has a similar high return with a lot less volatility? Would you choose General Motors because it is the least volatile? Or would you choose some combination of these? If so, which ones and how much of each? The answer is absolutely fantastic. And two people won Nobel Prizes for work related to this. But the answer is also very simple. Make your decision and then I'll explain. Motorola, you're right that people prefer greater returns to smaller returns, but they also prefer less risk. Continue and learn how portfolios give you higher return for the risk you take. Don't finish this lesson until you understand how owning individual stocks is owning uncompensated risk. Merck Pharmaceutical, that's a logical guess because of the high return for lower risk, but it is the wrong answer. Continue and learn how portfolios give you higher return for the risk you take. Don't finish this lesson until you understand how owning individual stocks is owning uncompensated risk. General Motors, it seems like this could be the right answer for a risk-averse person, but it's not. Continue and learn how portfolios give you higher return for the risk you take. Don't finish this lesson until you understand how owning individual stocks is owning uncompensated risk. You chose some combination of these stocks. Yes, the superior portfolio would own all the stocks, even McDonald's. It turns out that when you have three or more stocks and information about how the stock prices are correlated to each other, there are possible combinations of these stocks up and to the left of each of the individual stocks. We still need to work out how much of each to own. And if you keep adding stocks, you end up with something extraordinary. The best portfolio has the highest return per unit of risk. This is the market portfolio. It is the portfolio of every stock in the world held in its local currency with the proportion of every individual stock determined by its market capitalization. Well, those are some big words, but it simply means that instead of owning equal amounts of each stock, you hold them in proportion to how big they are. So if the price of Apple stock is $200 per share and there are 10 billion shares owned, then the market capitalization is $2 trillion. In this way, big companies like Apple and Exxon are proportionately bigger part of the preferred portfolio than, say, Merck Pharmaceutical or McDonald's. These portfolios are more efficient than any of the combinations that are below and to the right because they promise the same expected return for less risk. Remember, for any typical company like Motorola, the standard deviation around its expected return represents the volatility risk. For this market portfolio, all the company-specific risks get diversified away. Organizational risks like products, company leadership, their labor force. For those of you that were tempted to pick one of the individual stocks. I told you that owning individual stocks was owning uncompensated risk. Does this make sense to you now? For instance, owning Motorola is taking this much risk that you are not being compensated for. The market won't compensate you for taking that extra risk because everybody else can earn that same return for taking this much risk. Now, some of you will point out that any data set is always historical and cannot predict future performance. That's right. You cannot know the future. This is just a model, but it is useful and valuable. It's an answer to the questions, what stocks should I own and how much of each? This is called modern portfolio theory, and it's over 70 years old. And it says that it is not enough to look at the expected risk and return of individual stocks. By investing in many stocks, you both improve the return and reduce the riskiness of the portfolio. You can easily create attractive portfolios without Warren Buffett's skills. There's no forecasting here. We're not trying to pick stocks. We're not trying to predict how the market's going to do the next month. All we're assuming is that the means and variances are stable over time, and the correlation is stable over time. These are non-trivial assumptions, I grant you, but if you believe in those assumptions more than you believe in your ability to forecast what's going to happen to individual stocks 6 months from now, then this might be a good way to construct a portfolio. Let me offer an analogy. Let's say I've been writing down how long it takes me to drive home from a big city for 20 years now. Can I predict how long it will take me to drive home on some future date? It would be a wild guess because I can't predict the weather, traffic accidents, road construction. On the other hand, I have some information that's stable. The average commute time gives me the expected commute time, and the standard deviation tells me how volatile that estimate is. And I additionally know that my drive time is highly correlated with workday rush hour. You've just learned something extraordinary. The market portfolio promises the maximum return per unit of volatility risk. And collectively, this is what we all want to own. It's what we do own. It's not a new idea. And the whole mutual fund industry has exploded to provide you with what we all want, this prepackaged diversification, easy and convenient for a very low cost. In rule number 3, I said that choosing between risky and safe investments is a goal-by-goal decision. This is probably your most important decision. So let's get our arms around that now. It's very interesting. But first, where is this safe investment? Where would you put a risk-free asset on the chart? Let's say there's a bond that anybody can buy that's backed by the US government, yields a small amount of interest, and grows with inflation, so there's no inflation risk. Make your decision, and then we'll discuss how to do this. Would it be here, zero risk, zero real return? Or here, zero risk, high return? Or here, high risk, zero real return? A risk-free asset would be here. It might be something like an I bond. It's backed by the US government, so it has the highest possible credit rating in the world. It might have zero or low interest rate, so it's essentially the value does not change with interest rates. And it tracks the consumer price index, so there's no inflation risk. Or it could be an FDIC insured bank savings account that pays enough to keep up with inflation. Or it could be a good money market fund that does the same. Continue and learn how this all comes together for you now. So now you have two things you can allocate your money between. Somewhere to put money that's risk-free, the safe part of your portfolio, and the risky part of your portfolio, which is the market portfolio of all the publicly traded stocks. This is the portfolio that everybody in the world would prefer if there was no cost to own it. Why do I say that? Because when you are mixing a risky stock portfolio with a risk-free asset, you cannot get a steeper line. That's the highest return that you can get per unit of risk. If you need money on a certain date and you don't want to risk it being in a volatile stock market, then you would gradually move money out of the stock market and down this line. The efficient frontier becomes this straight line between 100% risk-free assets and 100% the market portfolio. If there's an acceptable risk level that you can live with, you can stay with a fixed allocation between the market portfolio and your risk-free choices. There's lots of choices for this risk-free part of your portfolio, but that's for another lesson. If bigger risks and returns are for you, you can mortgage your house and buy more of the market portfolio and beat your friends that are gambling with uncompensated risk. Isn't this great? There are thousands and thousands of individual stocks, and the combinations of the stocks are in baskets called mutual funds and electronically traded funds. But all you need to care about is owning the market portfolio and some version of a risk-free portfolio. We've covered a lot of ground in this lesson, but it's worth it for you to make good decisions about how to own stock and to stick with those decisions. You need to understand that this can really be simple. Can I summarize the four important points in this lesson and give you some final thoughts? When you have three or more different stocks, there will always be combinations with better risk return than they have individually. Company-specific risks can be diversified away, and all that remains is the market risk. Things like interest rates, currency risk, and recessions. You can mitigate this risk by allocating between the market portfolio and your version of a risk-free asset. Owning individual stocks is to own uncompensated risk because other investors don't need to take that risk to get that return. And there's a portfolio that everybody collectively prefers and should theoretically individually prefer. It's called the market portfolio and yields the greatest return for risk. It owns every publicly traded stock in the world in proportion to its size or market capitalization. Today, you can closely approximate this with a low-cost index fund. Thanks. I'll see you in the next video where you will learn how tempting it is to be your own worst enemy.